It's beginning to look a lot like Christmas. Everywhere you go, take a look at the 5 and 10, glistening once again with candy canes and silver lanes aglow. It's beginning to look a lot like Christmas. Toys in every store, but the prettiest thing to see is the holly that will be on your own front door. A pair of humble underturned pistol shirts is the wish of Barney and Ben. Those that look tall can go for a walk is the hope of Janice and Jen. And Mom and Dad can hardly wait for school to start again. It's beginning to look a lot like Christmas. Everywhere you go, there's a tree in the grand hotel, one in the park as well. The sturdy kind that does. It's beginning to look a lot like Christmas. Everywhere you go, there's a tree in the grand hotel, one in the park as well. The sturdy kind that doesn't mind the snow. It's beginning to look a lot like Christmas. Soon the bells will start, and the thing
Christmas is a time for music. Let's take a minute and listen to the poetic words of a good Christmas song, Hark the Herald Angels Sing. Hark, the herald angels sing, glory to the newborn King. Peace on earth and mercy mild, God and sinners reconciled. Joyful all ye nations rise, join the triumph of the skies. With the angelic host proclaim, Christ is born in Bethlehem. Hark! The herald angels sing, glory to the newborn King. Christ by highest heaven adored, Christ the everlasting Lord. Late in time behold him come, offspring of the virgin's womb. Veiled in flesh the Godhead see, hail the incarnate deity. Pleased as man with man to dwell, Jesus our Emmanuel. Mild he lays his glory by, born that man no more may die. Born to raise the sons of earth, born to give him second birth. Risen with healing in his wings, light and life to all he brings. Hail the Son of Righteousness. Hail the heaven-born Prince of Peace. Hail the heaven-born Prince of Peace. Hail the Son of Righteousness. Light and life to all he brings, risen with healing in his wings. Mild he lay his glory by, born that man no more may die. Come, desire of nations, come, fix in us thy humble home. Rise the woman's conquering seed, bruise in us the serpent's head. Adam's likeness now efface, stamp the image in its place. Hark, the herald angels sing, glory to the newborn King.
It seems the magic slipped away. find ourselves again on Christmas Day. Believe in what your heart is saying. Hear the melody that's playing. There's no time to waste. There's so much to celebrate. Believe in what you feel inside and give your dreams the wings to fly. You have everything you need if you just believe.
I'm excited to be sharing this music tonight. I haven't practiced that much recently, but I think it's important that in the Christmas season we have music. And one of the songs I love playing in brass ensembles is called Lo, How a Rose Air Blooming. I'm sharing Lo, How a Rose Air Blooming, an arrangement by the Canadian Brass Quintet, and I'm playing on the trombone that was my mother's for a number of years, and the lamp that is over my shoulder when I'm playing is my father's trombone that's turned into a lamp. Music and Christmas go together in our family for years, and it's fun to share this. It's not polished, but I offer it in the sense of music as part of the Christmas season, so I offer this to you all as part of our ThreeHouse family. Hope you enjoy it. Thank you.
Hi everyone, my name is Robin, and I would like to share a poem with you called The Smells of Christmas. I love the smell of Christmas, along with all the lights. Log fires in the fireplace on those cold winter nights. The smell of Christmas goodies that are baked with tender care. That smell is just the greatest. There's nothing to compare. The evergreens so fragrant, the smell of Christmas season, like the hanging of the mistletoe that's done for good reason. The red berries of the holly in that arrangement on the table, which I'm sure is much better than Christmas in that stable. Poinsettias all around to balance off the garland. Music boxes every place, bought by my sweet darling. Cinnamon and peppermint fill the air that's in our house, and what's stirring in the night is not the Christmas mouse. Those pies that make me drool just sitting there on that shelf. It's as if they were made special for that jolly old Christmas elf. Merry Christmas to you all.
Hi, it's Teddy the Brave, and I'm going to be singing a little bit of God Rest You Merry Gentlemen, along with O Come, O Come, Emmanuel. God rest ye merry gentlemen, let nothing you dismay. Remember that the Savior was born upon this day to save us all from Satan's power when we were gone astray. Oh, tidings of comfort and joy, comfort and joy. Oh, tidings of comfort and joy. O come, Emmanuel, and ransom captive Israel that mourns in lowly exile. Until the Son of God appears. Rejoice, rejoice, Emmanuel shall come to thee, O Israel. O tidings of comfort and joy.
Hi, my name is Amanda Vasey, and this is my sister,
Claire Vasey.
And today we're going to read The Night Before Christmas. "'Twas the night before Christmas when all through the house, not a creature was stirring, not even a mouse.
The stockings were hung by the chimney with care in hopes that St. Nicholas soon would be there.
The children were nestled all snug in their beds with visions of sugar plums danced in their heads.
And Mama in her kerchief and I in my cap had just settled down for a long winter's nap.
When out on the lawn there rose such a clatter, I sprang from my bed to see what was the matter.
Away to the window I flew like a flash, tore open the shutters and threw up the sash.
The moon on the breast of the new fallen snow gave a luster of midday objects below.
When what to my wondering eyes should appear but a miniature sleigh and 8 tiny reindeer.
With a little old driver so lively and quick, I knew in a moment it must be St. Nick.
More rapid than eagles, his coursers, they came, and he whistled and shouted and called them by name.
Now Dasher, now Dancer, now Prancer and Vixen, on Comet, on Cupid, on Donner and Blitzen. To the top of the porch, to the top of the wall, now dash away, dash away, dash away all.
As dryly as before, the wild hurricane fly, when they meet with an obstacle, mount to the sky.
So up to the housetop, the coursers they flew, with a sleigh full of toys, and St. Nicholas too.
And then in a twinkling, I heard on the roof the prancing and pawing of each little hoof.
As I drew in my head and was turning around, down the chimney St. Nicholas came with a bound.
He was dressed all in fur, and from his head to his foot, and all his clothes were all tarnished with ashes and soot.
A bundle of toys he had flung on his back, and he looked like a peddler just opening his pack.
His eyes how they twinkled, his dimples how merry, his cheeks were like roses, his nose like a cherry.
His droll little mouth was drawn up like a bow, and his beard on his chin was as white as the snow.
The stump of a pipe he held tight in his teeth, and the smoke in it encircled his head like a reef.
He had a broad face and a little round belly that shook when he laughed like a bowl full of jelly.
He was chubby and plump, a right jolly old elf, and I laughed when I saw him in spite of myself.
In a wink of his eye and the twist of his head soon gave me to know I had nothing to dread.
He spoke not a word, but went straight to his work, and filled all the stockings, then turned with a jerk.
And laying his finger aside of his nose, and giving a nod up the chimney he rose.
He sprang to his sleigh, to his team gave a whistle, and away they all flew like the down of a thistle.
But I heard him explain as he drove out of sight, "Merry Christmas to all, and to all a good night." The end. Merry Christmas from ThreeHouse.
Round yon virgin, Days, a decree went out from Caesar Augustus that all the world should be registered. This was the first registration when Quirinius was governor of Syria, and all went to be registered, each to his own town, and Joseph also went up from Galilee, from the town of Nazareth, to Judea, to the city of David, which is called Bethlehem, because he was of the house and lineage of David, to be registered with Mary, his betrothed, who was with child. And while they were there, the time came for her to give birth, and she gave birth to her firstborn son and wrapped him in swaddling clothes and laid him in a manger, because there was no place for them in the inn. And in the same region there were shepherds out in the field, keeping watch over their flock by night. And an angel of the Lord appeared to them, and the glory of the Lord shone around them, and they were filled with great fear. And the angel said to them, "Fear not, for behold, I bring you good news of a great joy that will be for all people. For unto you is born this day in the city of David a Savior, who is Christ the Lord. And this will be a sign for you. You will find a baby wrapped in swaddling clothes and laying in a manger." And suddenly there was with the angel a multitude of the heavenly host, praising God and saying, "Glory to God in the highest, and on earth peace among those with whom he is pleased." I'm Pastor Mark Anderson. Merry Christmas.
Merry early Christmas, ThreeHouse folks. My name is Albie Nickel. I use he, him, his pronouns, and I'm one of the many student leaders here at ThreeHouse, a collaborative campus ministry. I wanted to share my favorite Christmas song with all of you, O Come, Emmanuel, and I hope you will sing with me if you know it. O come, Emmanuel, and ransom captive Israel, that mourns in lonely exile here, until the Son of God appear. Rejoice, rejoice, Emmanuel, shall come to thee, O Israel. O come, desire of nations, as one the hearts of all mankind. Bid out our sad divisions cease, and be thyself our King of peace. Rejoice, rejoice, Emmanuel, shall come to thee, Israel.
Have a wonderful Christmas, and I cannot wait to see you in 2021. Blessed assurance, Jesus is yours.
This is a special time of year for all of us. Many Christmas memories come back, and I'd like to share with you this morning one of the pieces that I first heard back when I was a child, and it meant something to me because my grandfather had shoemaking equipment in his basement, and I used to play with it a lot. And so the first time I heard this story, immediately my thoughts went to the amount of work and time that he probably put in making and repairing shoes. So the story itself is The Elves and the Shoemaker by the Brothers Grimm, one of their many tales that they told. It is a story that talks about the need to share, and especially when you have more to be able to share with those who have less. So the story is The Elves and the Shoemaker, and this is it. A shoemaker, by no fault of his own, had become so poor that at last he had nothing left but leather for one pair of shoes. So in the evening, he cut out the shoes which he wished to begin to make the next morning. And as he had a good conscience, he lay down quietly in his bed, commended himself to God, and fell asleep. In the morning, after he had said his prayers and was just going to sit down to work, the two shoes stood quite finished on his table. He was astounded and knew not what to say to it. He took the shoes in his hands to observe them closer, and they were so neatly made that there was not one bad stitch in them, just as if they were intended as a masterpiece. Soon after, a buyer came in, and as the shoes pleased him so well, he paid more for them than was customary, and with the money, the shoemaker was able to purchase leather for two pairs of shoes. He cut them out at night, and next morning was about to set to work with fresh courage, but he had no need to do so, for when he got up, they were already made, and buyers also were not wanting, who gave him money enough to buy leather for four pairs of shoes. The following morning, too, he found the four pairs made, and so it went on constantly. What he cut out in the evening was finished by the morning, so that he soon had his honest independence again, and at last became a wealthy man. Now, it befell that one evening, not long before Christmas, when the man had been cutting out, he said to his wife, before going to bed, "What think you if we stay up tonight to see who it is that lends us this helping hand?" The woman liked the idea and lighted a candle, and then they hid themselves in a corner of the room behind some clothes which were hanging up there and watched. When it was midnight, two pretty little naked men came, sat down by the shoemaker's table, took all the work which was cut out before them, and began to stitch and sew and hammer so skillfully and so quickly with their little fingers that the shoemaker could not turn away his eyes for astonishment. They did not stop until all was done and stood finished on the table, and they ran quickly away. Next morning, the woman said, "The little men have made us rich, and we really must show that we are grateful for it. They run about so and have nothing on and must be cold. I tell thee what I'll do. I will make them little shirts and coats and vests and trousers and knit both of them a pair of stockings. And do thou too make them two little pairs of shoes." The man said, "I shall be very glad to do it." And one night, when everything was ready, they laid their presents all together on the table instead of the cutout work, and they concealed themselves to see how the little men would behave. At midnight, they came bounding in and wanted to get to work at once, but as they did not find any leather cut out, but only the pretty little articles of clothing, they were at first astonished, and then they showed intense delight. They dressed themselves with the greatest rapidity, putting the pretty clothes on and singing, "Now we are boys so fine to see, why should we longer cobblers be?" Then they danced and skipped and leapt over chairs and benches. At last, they danced out the doors. From that time forth, they came no more. But as long as the shoemaker lived, all went well with him, and all his undertakings prospered. Merry Christmas, everybody.
been sent. The Christmas rush is through, but I still have one wish to make. A special one for you. Merry Christmas, darling. We're apart, that's true. But I can dream, and in my dream, I'm Christmasing with you. Holidays are joyful. There's always something new, but every day's a holiday when I'm near to you. The lights on the tree, I wish you could see. I wish it every day. To see you and to say that I wish you Merry Christmas. Happy New Year too. I've just one wish on this Christmas Eve. I wish I were. To see you and to say that I wish you Merry Christmas. Happy New Year too. I've just one wish on this Christmas Eve. I wish I were with you. Wish I were with you.
Merry Christmas, darling. Descending Theology, The Nativity, by Mary Carr. She bore no more than other women bore, but in her belly's globe that desert night, the earth's full burden swayed. Maybe she held it in her clasped hands as expecting women often do, or monks in prayer. Maybe at the womb's first clutch, she briefly felt that star shine as a blade point, but uttered no curses. Then in the stable she writhed and heard beasts stomp in their stalls, their tails sweeping side to side, and between contractions her skin flinched with the thousand animal itches that plague a standing beast's sleep. But in the muted womb world, with its glutinous liquid, the child knew nothing of its own fire. No one ever does, though our names are said to be writ down before we come to be. He came out, a sticky grub, flailing the load of his own limbs, and was bound in cloth, his cheek brushed with fingerprint touch. So his lolling head lurched, and the sloppy mouth found that first fullness, her milk, spilled along his throat while his pure being flooded her. Each feeds the other. Then he was left in the grain bin. Some animal muzzle against his swaddling perhaps breathes him warm till sleep came pouring, that first draught of death, the one he'd wake from, as we all do, screaming.
Good evening, everyone. Tonight I'll be playing some holiday tunes for you. Up first, I'll be playing God Rest Ye Merry Gentlemen. And up after that will be Joy to the World. I'll be playing two verses of each just because they're a bit shorter.
ThreeHouse. Tonight I'll be reading from The Stillness of Winter by Barbara Mahaney, and this reading is called Being Still. Curious thing, this December, more than ever, it is the stillness that speaks to me, that I seek, that I long for, that some days I grope towards as if blind and making my way through the woods at night. It is as if the deep, dark stillness itself is divining me towards home, which of course it is. It always has been. Oh, there is noise all right this December, clanging like cymbals in my ears, the squawking of the news and the screeching of the brakes. But I am, in my best moments, pushing it away. I take it in long, stiff drinks, the news, the noise, the grave distractions. But then I do odd things. I lift the blinds at night so I can watch the snowflakes tumbling. I wind the clock and I listen to its mesmerizing tick and tock. I sit, nose pressed to the frosty pane of glass, and I watch the scarlet cardinal on the bough outside. I am practicing the art of being still. Stillness, when you look at it, is never very far away and it's not too hard to grasp. I find, though, that it takes a dose of concentration and sometimes a stern reminder. I mumble to myself, just be still. It is, in fact, the heart and the soul that are the vessels of pure, true stillness. Those chambers deep inside us that allow for the holy to unfold. The birthing rooms, perhaps, of our most essential stirrings. To be at one with all that matters. To begin the pulse beat there where the quiet settles in and the knowing reigns. It is, yes, in the stillness that the sacred comes. I wish for you this Christmas season to find your still and sit in it. Merry Christmas.